You're the winner!
Come on, Marcus.
Yeah, I got it. I've been a member since 1976. Thank you.
Hey, Pat.
Yep, you're right. Thank you for catching that.
And they'll be holding a discussion on graduated driver's license laws, enforcement, and risk. Let us know how we're doing with our teen driver fairs.
To take, but I can tell you if you're over 21 and you refuse to do the field sobriety test or the blood.
The driver that's under 18 for driving other kids in their car, they're also.
Great, that's a great segue then.
Hello, everybody. Thank you very much for coming. I hope to establish with you a brief dialogue.
From the standpoint of a parent who is also a trauma surgeon, that sees the other side of this problem of teen driving and who sees all the devastating consequences of some of the things that are going on out there. So let me tell you a little bit about myself. I am the person who runs the trauma center at University Hospital, a level one trauma center in Hillcrest. Before we engage into this conversation about teen driving and how I see it and what we see in the trauma center, I just want to tell you a little bit about trauma. 15 seconds about trauma. The public's perception about trauma and about what we do in the trauma center is that trauma is something random that happens because it just happens. And it's not a disease. I can tell you that we understand trauma from a very different standpoint. We understand trauma as a disease because we can define it. We know how it presents, we know how to treat it, and more importantly, we know how to prevent. So trauma is a disease, but I usually say that trauma is a disease linked to human stupidity. So if we could find a cure for human stupidity, we would find a cure for trauma. At least 98% of all the injuries that we see on the trauma center. And that's what we will talk about. But if you look at this graph, this is a large national database that exists at the American College of Surgeons. All trauma centers in the country send data to this database. And as you can see, if you look at the incidence of trauma, trauma occurs in people that are at the age between 10 and 40 for the most part, individuals in the most productive years of their lives. And it turns out that for each person that dies from trauma, there are 3 to 5 people that will be impaired for life. So this is a tremendous burden to society because 1 people die, but 5 won't be productive anymore. So no matter how hard we work and how good the trauma centers and the trauma system is, we won't be able to bring them back to society. So that's very important. So let's talk a little bit about distracted driving. You've heard this throughout the day today. I just want to tell you that driver inattention is a big deal. And there are about 6,000 people that die in crashes involving distracted driving. When we talk about driving distraction, I want to point to you that there are three types of distraction. There is visual distraction, when you basically take your eyes off the road. Then there is manual distraction, when you take your hands off the wheel. How many times do you see that happening? When you go grab your coffee, a can of soda, or you're going to grab your phone or your iPod, etc. And then there's the cognitive distraction. Your hands are on the wheel, your eyes are on the road, but your brain is just not there. So all those things will let you just lose focus and eventually get into an accident. This is something that I wanted you to take home. If you look at this graph, those numbers there indicate the risk, the increased risk of one getting involved in a crash. And here you see different types of behaviors. So if you have a blood alcohol level of 0.08 compared to a normal person that's not drunk, the chances of getting into an accident is twofold higher. Now, it's a little higher if you're dialing on your cell phone while you're driving. So actually, if you're talking on your cell phone or manipulating your phone, you're as impaired as if you were drunk, just about. Now, how many times you drive in the freeway in the morning? I do that every day to go to work, and I see people shaving, women applying makeup. Well, that's about three times higher the risk of getting into an accident if you are not doing any of those things. Some people read their emails. BlackBerry vibrates. Immediately you reach it, and you try to read and drive with one hand. About 3.5 fold increased risk. Looking at an external object goes up. If you're moderately or severely drowsy, your risk goes up to 6-7 fold. And if you're reaching for a moving object, so let's say you have your phone in your center console, and then you make a curve and the phone flies to the passenger seat, and you try to reach it, the risk of getting into a car crash is about 8-9 fold higher. So all those things we see happening every day. I like this last quote very much. Your brain power, the brain power used while driving decreases by 40% when the driver listens to a conversation or to music. So this goes back to what the policemen were just talking about 10 minutes ago. Teenagers, they load their car with their friends and they start talking and they listen to loud music and your brain just doesn't work very well. And that's what it will do it for you. So a little more of the facts. We know that, as again, drivers are talking on their cell phones are more impaired than drivers that are drunk. And about 1 million people in this country chat on their phones or send text messages while driving. That's a reality. We see that happening every day. So how many times have you seen people doing all of this when they are driving? You know, I mentioned shaving, applying makeup, but people eat, people drink, smoke. I saw once a lady putting in contact lenses while she was driving. Incredible, but that happens. And so all this behavior should be avoided. So this is for the teenagers in the room, okay? I have a 17-year-old daughter. She's driving. We had to go through this list of things. I know that every once in a while they do something stupid. We all do. But for the teenagers, these are the take-home messages. Stay focused and pay attention. Try to avoid interacting with passengers. Try to avoid talking while driving, taking your eyes off the road. Keep your hands on the wheel. These are simple things. And they are sort of intuitive. But if we don't talk about it, they won't pay attention to it. Avoid driver fatigue. Stay focused on the road. Don't daydream. Don't drive if you're tired. Call your mom, call your dad. Hey, dad, pick me up. We'll be proud of you. Don't drive when you're angry or upset. You know, you're not paying attention when you're angry or upset. And if you need to use your cell phone while driving, just pull off the road. Talk on your cell phone, that's okay. You have your phone, you need to talk on your cell phone, but pull off the road. Just don't do those things together. Going back a little, I don't want to show you any bloody pictures. I have thousands of pictures to show you if you're interested. But I just want to tell you what happens, what we see in the trauma center. When you take your eyes off the road and you speed up and you're not seeing the car in front of you, you're going to crash. And these are the injuries. You have your body against the steering wheel, you have injury to internal organs, injury to your ribs. If you're not wearing your seatbelt, you're gonna hit your head against the windshield, and you may go under the steering wheel, and you may have injuries to your lower extremities and pelvis. So your whole body may be injured. So there are national initiatives to increase awareness, and I think that's one of my goals today, is to increase awareness for you. This is the National Safety Council, on the road, off the phone. That's the message you gotta deliver to your kids. Or this one, this is a very, very cool website from the Department of Transportation. Just simply put it down. And why? Because you just can't do two things at once, driving and doing something else. And younger drivers are especially at risk because they're more distracted, they don't have the experience, and they text more than any other age group. So this is a reality. And for the parents, just to wrap this up, you can make a difference. Talk to your teen about the dangers of driving. Express your concerns about his or her safety and well-being. It's very important to establish that dialogue. Extend your teen's supervised driving period. If you feel that they are not prepared, just say so. And set the rules of the road. Make sure your teen always wear a seatbelt. Limit nighttime driving. Restrict the number of teen passengers in the car. These are things that you can do. You can enforce those rules. Make sure that if necessary, you can establish a parenting contract where you establish the rules and the punishment if they break the rules. That's okay, because it's your son, it's your daughter, it's your responsibility. And define the consequences if they break the rules. For instance, when you define your own graduate driving rules, make sure that they follow it for at least 1 year. Consider limiting driving at night, at bad weather, with other teens, or on high-speed roads. Don't rush to give them a car. It's better if they drive your car than if you give them a car right off the bat. Make sure that they gain that experience over time. And by the way, they listen to you, so set a good example. So if you tell them don't text, but you do, if you tell them don't talk on the phone, but you do, that's not a good example. So you gotta set a good example, because your child mimics your behaviors. And you are the parent. It's your car. It's your insurance. You are responsible. And more importantly, it's your child. This is not about the drinking, but I think we've done a great job about drinking and driving in this country. Obviously, we can always do better, but we haven't done a good job about cell phones and texting and distractions in the car. So prevention is the daughter of intelligence. We can prevent this. And to wrap this up, this is an old advertisement of the Trauma Research Education Foundation that I found in my office 20 years ago. Trauma, it's preventable. We thought it was preventable then, and we think it's preventable now. So thank you very much. I'll be available for questions. And if you want, visit us at UCSD, trauma, traumaucsd.edu. Thank you very much for your attention.